Hi, it's Jeff Alpin, the Day Game Hunter, and welcome to Career Coach Office Hours. New time, same days, Tuesdays and Fridays, now at 1 p.m. Eastern. I take questions from you about job search, hiring more effectively, management, leadership, dealing with workplace issues, because folks need help. And too often, the advice that they get from well-meaning people isn't particularly good, to be frank with you. So what I've chosen to do is this live stream and provide information to you on an as-need basis. Now, I'll also remind you that my website has a ton there. So, sorry, I clicked on the wrong one. All right, did I enter it twice? Oh, I didn't do the right thing. Bear with me one second so I can fix this. But the long and the short of it is, what I try to do is give you great information. And if you need personalized attention, you can come to me for coaching. Now, here we go. So you can always visit my website, which is thebiggamehunter.us. Let me get that going. So you just visit my website, thebiggamehunter.us. There you can schedule time for a free discovery call or schedule time for coaching. Find out about my blog, which has more than 12,000 searchable posts. Find out about my books and guides to job search. And there's just a lot there. In addition, I host JobSearchTV.com on YouTube and Amazon. And, you know, again, it's video material there. It's also available through my site, but you get it faster usually through JobSearchTV.com. And then from there, my podcast, No BS Job Search Advice Radio, is the number one podcast and Apple podcast for job search, with more than 2,300 episodes over more than 11 years. So I create a lot of great information because I know people don't know how to hire a coach. You know, sometimes you get a recommendation, sometimes, you know, LinkedIn makes suggestions, but I want you to get to know me and get to know how I think so that in this way, if you need advice, if you need support with your job search, with hiring more effectively, with management, leadership, or dealing with a particular workplace issue, you can come to me for advice, and I'd be happy to support you. Now, when I was doing the show at 9:15, I did a coffee toast, but I'm not in the mood for coffee right now, so an acknowledgement to those of you, it's a water sip that I'll do, acknowledgement to those of you who care. And you put in best effort into your work most days, almost all days, because it matters to you that the people you serve get the best from you. So an acknowledgement to you who do that. A quick toast, and I have a bunch of questions. And I'll just remind you, if you've got a question for me about job search, hiring, management, leadership, or some advice about a workplace issue, just put it into chat. I'd be very happy to answer your question for you, okay? Now, let me just scroll down so I can see when someone puts something into the comments. So, as I said, I have a number of questions from people. And the first one is, do LinkedIn shares get lots of views? And the answer is, not really. Now, if you tag people, they're likely to see it. And that's going to enhance the views of your shares, of your posts on LinkedIn. Now, again, if you're not tagging, it's, remember, there's a scroll that's going on, with the result being, you know, people aren't going to spot it. Like for someone like me who's got 26, 27,000 first level connections, the likelihood I'm going to see a share or a post from someone's pretty small. But if you tag someone, they're likely to see it and comment on it. So direct shares without tagging, no. With tagging, you'll minimally get the people who you've tagged commenting on what you posted. Who is responsible for cultivating a culture of collaboration in large companies? And they define that as 250 plus employees. Well, it starts off with everyone. You know, even in the most cutthroat environment, you can foster a culture of cooperation. And thus, yes, one thinks of senior management as being responsible for the culture, but they're not really doing that. They may have, you know, done something similar years before during startup phases or when they first joined, but you know, the reality is managers do it, staff does it, and everyone is a participant in creating culture. You can blame other people for how the environment is. You can also conduct yourself in a collaborative way, knowing that initially it's not going to be received, but you can be the sponsor of the behavior and get the result that you want in the environment, as so many people do. After all, when you think about, you know, the way much of Western culture has been created, you know, there have been aggressive people, there have been peaceful people, and we don't tend to acknowledge the peaceful ones. We tend to focus on the more aggressive ones. Yet people like Gandhi, thank you, Zubair, you're absolutely right, cross-cultural management, and I'll comment about that in a moment. So people can create the environment that they want. And it just involves perseverance and persistence in the face of resistance if that's not the culture that you've stepped into. So the notion of cross-cultural management is complicated for a lot of organizations because, as exists so often, there's a dominant culture and there's a non-dominant culture. Just as we talk about multicultural issues or diversity issues, there's one culture that tends to dominate. They have power and authority. But how do you respond to that? And that's how you can shift a culture without necessarily being aggressive in response, because I'm going to work with the assumption that the aggressive culture is the dominant one, because that's the way it tends to be most of the time. But since we've been asked about collaboration, I'll deal with the alternative, which is dog-eat-dog. You know, everyone out for himself, every woman or man out for themselves. And someone has to start the shift. And that can be you. So who's responsible? Everyone's responsible for the culture in an organization. What you do to change it is your choice. And you may not get a lot of support. But since peace exists, it comes from within. That's my belief. That's Buddhist belief and many other cultures. Start with yourself and keeping a peaceful mind as you deal with the adversity of complicated situations that you're trying to respond to. And you'll find with time you will shift the culture, just as Gandhi did and others have throughout the world. Next question. I'll just remind you again, if you've got a comment or a question, put it in the chat. Be happy to respond to it. What happens after I have cleared all the interviews in a company? Okay, you got through all the interviews. Woohoo! Doesn't mean you're hired. Doesn't mean you've been rejected. They are evaluating multiple people concurrently most of the time. And the result winds up being eventually they have to make a decision. Usually in firms, they're deciding, you know, on the basis of conversations, notes, comments that have been recorded by interviewers, what they think about you and your experience and skills. And from there, eventually they can make the point of making a choice. And the choice can be, we're going to keep interviewing, by the way. It doesn't mean you've been hired. It doesn't mean you're rejected. It means they've come to the end of the process for now. And now they have a decision to make. Three choices: you, someone else, or let's keep talking to people. That's what happens. The next question is, can you become a project manager with an MBA? Yeah, you can become a project manager with an MBA, but you know, the criteria for being an effective project manager goes beyond the MBA. So this training and experiences that you should have about, you know, organizing and structure that your program may or may not have provided you with. The next part of this is, will someone give you that opportunity without practical experience doing it? The answer is also rarely. It happens at smaller firms or maybe government agencies where they're willing to take a shot on someone and they save some money because they're not going to pay you a premium firm's rates. But yeah, it's possible. Probable, no, because you probably don't have the real experience that someone would look for in a project manager to coordinate such a role. So don't hold your breath. Talk to people about what they did to land in these roles as a way of understanding what's going to be needed of you to step up. Should you reply back to a rejection email sent by your interviewer and or HR? I think you never know when you run into people again. So arguing is not a smart approach. No, you're wrong. I can do that job. No one asked me about it. Don't do that kind of stuff. It's immature. Thank you for your consideration. I appreciate the opportunity to meet with you. Sorry that I wasn't quite strong enough or didn't satisfy your requirements. You can then ask, I'm curious, where did you perceive the deficiency? Now, often they'll respond with, oh, we just saw someone who had much more experience than you, who is willing to work within our budget. Or they'll say, you were outside of our price point. Now, notice it's the two extremes. But, you know, it's a courteous way of bringing this to a conclusion, just to ask where the deficiency was. And rather than arguing, whatever they say is fine, and you just respond with, thank you, good luck, send a LinkedIn connection request to them as well, so that this way you can use their network as a way of part of your networking to find work. Because they are generally more experienced, have larger networks, and thus you can leverage off of that in the future. How can I politely fire someone? My employee is no longer reliable, always has excuses not to come in, or just doesn't reply. I've never had to fire anyone, so how could I do it without being mean? Well, your manner is going to dictate a lot of this, but I'll start off with meet with your HR rep, meet with your HR business partner, and say, you know, I'm having an issue with so-and-so. This is what is happening. I'd like to put them on a performance improvement plan where my expectations are very clear about what they need to do. And within 30 days, they need to perform to my expectation or they're gone. This is a US-centric answer. So in responding, all you do is you're getting confirmation from your business partner, your HR person, that you want to write them up for a performance improvement plan. Lay out precise expectations for their performance and what they need to do to keep their job after 30 days. If they don't do it, it's grounds for termination right then and there. So don't just fire them. Give them a chance to recover. If they don't show up, they've made a choice. If they don't show up and don't communicate, they've made a choice. It's an immature behavior on their part, but that's the way to do it. A performance improvement plan, 30-day expectations of improved performance, and then from there, they don't perform, they are gone. Okay? So again, put your questions about job search hiring, management, leadership, dealing with particular workplace issues in the chat, I'd love to help you. So let's just see where we go to next. I apologize. Scrolling does that sometimes where I lose track of where I am. If you schedule me for an interview at 2 p.m. and I don't show up until 2:45, would you still be waiting for me at the interview, or would you have left and given up? Now, let me start with the premise of everyone has a mobile phone. Why didn't you call? Don't put it on them, because that's really what happens here. You know, you're going, what's wrong with this person? You know, it was traffic. And, I couldn't be there at 2 o'clock. I got there at 2:45 because it was an accident. Why didn't you call them and tell them that? If you tell people that, they can respond with, I've got a 2:30 interview or a 3 o'clock, arriving at 2:45 with a 3 o'clock appointment behind you, 15 minutes isn't enough. Why don't we reschedule? The issue isn't that you got there 2:45 for me. It's that you haven't called and you have a phone and you have the ability to call a main number, ask to be connected with someone, or may even have that person's phone number. And if this was over video, you got no chance. You have no chance because they sent you an email with the invitation and you didn't send the response saying, I'm running late. I'll probably be available at 2:45. Could we do it then? No, you just decide to pop in when you could. So, no, I wouldn't wait. You know, for me, 15 minutes is max. Most occasions, 10 minutes after is the courtesy I extend to someone. You screwed up. It's really that simple. A related question to an earlier one. Have you used the PIP to fire employees? I'm going to respond to the language here because you don't use it to fire people. What you do is you use it to be clear about where the performance issues are, to give them a chance to fix them. And if they don't fix them, they're gone. So for example, someone I work with is a sales leader. And when he puts staff on performance improvement plans, yes, they're not doing sales. And with some people, he may require that they do a sale or two or whatever by the end of the timeline given, which is usually a 90-day window. Or, you know, he can say to them, you know, you're just not putting in doing the performance that we expect. We expect you to be talking to a certain number of people per day, per week, or what have you, and you're not doing it. So that's grounds for termination at the end of the period that HR validates this for. So I haven't personally done it, but people I coach have done it. And thus, at the end of the period of time, 30 days, 60 days, whatever it is, you've either done it or you're gone. Let me just do a quick check here. 1 second, please. Wrong tab. I apologize. Okay, let's continue on. Why have employers indicate that resumes are not as significant as in the past in the hiring process? Well, I think there's an age demographic issue here. And with less experienced people, for certain types of roles, a demonstration of their capabilities is far more beneficial than a resume. Let me illustrate. You know, if I'm doing recruiting and I'm on LinkedIn and I find a profile there that makes sense, I just contact the person, right? And I'm not seeing a resume, I'm seeing a LinkedIn profile. And I'm talking with someone about a role, seeing if they're interested, going into depth and trying to schedule an interview. That's what I did when I did search. And I know that's what hiring managers and talent acquisition professionals do when they're trying to find someone on LinkedIn. For me personally, I would go into my database. I would go onto LinkedIn. And going into the database, I might do direct mail to the people who fit the requirements because databases tend to become obsolete. So I'd want to see if they were qualified, interested, and available. And thus, in writing to them, I'd want to know what they were doing most recently. And thus, I could do with without a resume. When it came time to submitting something to my client, I'd often ask for a copy of the resume. But the real thing comes down to times are changing. And there's a great story. I shared it on JobSearchTV.com about a Gen Z job hunter. And what she was looking for was a job at Pixar. And she determined, well, no one from Pixar responded to her resume when it was submitted. So what she did, excuse me one second, what she did was go to the Pixar offices, get out some chalk, and start drawing on the sidewalk in front of their headquarters. She was looking for an animation job, and she wanted to illustrate her skills. The result winds up being that she got hired and never submitted a resume. Peggy Sue, bear with me just one second, okay? So there are situations now where people can demonstrate their experiences and be hired. If you are seen to be an expert and people contact you based upon LinkedIn profile, they've seen a YouTube video or listened to a podcast interview or seen you speak from the stage at a conference, then you're cutting the line and getting to the front. No resume, right? And that's really always what you want to be doing, figuring out ways to cut the line to get to the front so you're not another piece of cattle in the corral being processed into meat. So resumes, there are ways now to get around working us, connecting with a firm without a resume. As many of these as you can do, you're going to get results. So give it a shot and keep me posted, okay? Peggy Sue, Destination Services Consultant. I don't know what you're asking here, but if you tell me more, I'll comment, okay? While Peggy Sue's writing here, I'll just remind you to put your questions about job search, hiring better, management, leadership, or dealing with different workplace issues, put them in the chat. Also going to remind you about my website, thebiggamehunter.us, where you can schedule time for a free discovery call, a coaching session. Visit my blog for information. Find out about my books and courses for job hunting. There is a lot at that website. Like, again, 12,000 plus posts at this point. So now on to the next question. Why did my job interview last for an hour, but I still get a rejection? I was even offered a company tour by the recruiter. Well, what you learned is they give company tours to a lot of people, don't they? And they chose not to go further with you. Why? Two possibilities. Number one is you didn't do as well as you thought. Number two is someone did better. Remember, you're always competing. You're competing with other people. You're competing with the notion that someone else might be better out there. And the result winds up being you wind up in situations where you're going to interview and not get results. So my encouragement is wherever you can, focus on a great performance on your interview. If you think you did well, you did well. If you don't think you did well, you need to practice to improve. Practice, practice, practice. So what I'll say is the fact that they gave you a tour, the fact that you spent an hour there means nothing. They probably do that with everyone. So don't sweat it. On to the next thing. Next question. What is the riskiest question a job applicant may ask during an interview that will end any chances of getting hired? When I saw this, I was actually thinking of the riskiest question an applicant might be asked during an interview that will end their chances of getting hired. And that's the way I'm going to answer it. So the answer is, whenever you give an unpredictable answer that takes you off the standard script, you're at risk. And I say you're at risk because they may not get you. So, for example, if you're the person who cracks jokes on the interview, as you talk to people, you know, that's a risk item on your part. If you're someone who, let me just think of another example. The classic question, why do you want to work for us? And you gave an honest answer. I'm not sure that I do. What I want to do for now is learn more about your firm and the opportunity here. Get a sense of compensation, benefits, and a variety of other things to understand what I'm being brought on to do and what my comp might be like. So that in this way, you know, I can make a good decision. What they want to hear is something along the lines of, oh, yes, I'd be so excited to work for you. Oh, please. Why do I want to work for you? Why wouldn't I want to work for you? You know, you're a great company. You know, interesting people. Great job. You know, you can lay out all that stuff too. But the honest answer is, I don't know yet. I'm learning a lot more. And in doing so, I'm trying to make a decision about what's right for me as you're trying to make a decision about what's right for you. And that's a risk answer because you're not doing the, you know, the organ grinder and the monkey, with you being the monkey begging, oh, please give me this job. I really want this job. No, don't do that. The recruiter said, we're still interviewing a few more candidates from our end before making the decision. We'll give you an update by the end of the week. In the meantime, feel free to reach out if you have any more questions. Cheers. And then they want to know, is this good news? Well, you haven't been rejected yet, but they're still dating. And if you were booking a wedding hall for your wedding and the person who you were hoping to marry responded by saying, oh, you're a very attractive man or woman. And, you know, I'll be back to you by the end of the week to see if I'm interested. Okay. There's a message in the behavior. There's a message in the comment. And thus, it's not good news. At best, it's neutral news, but they haven't fallen in love yet. That's the fact of it. They haven't fallen in love. No love, no money, no honey. So you need more selling to do, more work to do to get this job. Excuse me. Not sure why I'm, I know why I'm getting tired. I'm under caffeinated. Normally when I do this show, I'm very well caffeinated. Today, I'm not. Sorry. Why would a hiring manager agree to an interview with the same candidate they interviewed for the same job and rejected 2 years before? Answer, because they hope you've gotten better. Seriously, they hope you'll have done better. So, you know, that's why they'll interview you, because now over 2 years, things have changed, right? So the long and the short of it is they want to evaluate you for where you are today. And they're hoping that you might be qualified for the role that they want. So that's why they do it. They don't view it from the standpoint of square peg, square hole, you know, square peg, round hole. So again, they're interviewing you 2 years later because you've changed for the last 2 years. Is a diversity push in companies leading to discriminatory hiring? No. No. I know the way the Department of Labor looks at this. Now, from a search firm perspective, you're not allowed to discriminate under any criteria under federal, state, or local law. It's just the way it is. You're not allowed to discriminate. As an employer, in theory, what you can do is widen the scope of your search to ensure that you're talking to people who are of color. So does it lead to discriminatory hiring? No, because behind this is the assumption that people were being discriminated against before. Catch that one. People were being discriminated against before. And now what we're trying to do is to ensure that we've opened up the criteria as broadly as possible so that we're able to get in, we're able to evaluate more people. So is it intrinsically discriminatory? No. Is there a point where some might question it? Of course. You know, and the probability is a person's not being discriminated against for racial reasons. Often, well, let me not go down that road. I'll just simply say, no. You know, discriminatory hiring is a figment of your imagination. They're looking to ensure that they've widened the scope of the search to make sure that they're talking to as many people of color, older individuals, younger individuals, people of a particular religion, people with disabilities. They're trying to ensure that they broaden the search to ensure that they're interviewing or evaluating as many people from diverse groups as possible. As of now, this is the last question I have for today. Let me just take a quick look in chat. No, Peggy Sue has not commented back about what she meant with destination services consultant. So let me come back here. How do headhunters find prospective candidates for a role that they're actively recruiting for? I'll tell you what I did. I did recruiting for a long time, filled a lot of positions around the United States and Canada. And when I started to search, I did a couple of things concurrently. Number one is I posted an ad on my website, on LinkedIn. My website was integrated with Indeed and a variety of other places. So this way I could start blasting out the people and have them be able to respond with information. Then from there, once that was done, I might do a direct mail piece out of my database to individuals who fit the criteria of the role. So I would do a search based upon keywords to identify people and seniority levels. So it could be on the basis of job title. It could be on the basis of, it was always on the basis of a title and skills. Now, title, can be complicated because if this person went into my system 4 years ago, they probably outgrew the title. But I'm mainly starting off with the requirements of the position and looking for keywords that make sense. I would try to narrow it because often I'd come up. My database had like 270,000 records in it when I stopped doing recruiting. So a lot of people. And what I'd want to do is try to narrow it down based upon criteria. Then from there, I'd also talk to people I knew who might have a similar background, who I thought might be able to refer me to someone who would make sense. So it was a three-pronged strategy that would allow me to start making touches with people and start having conversations with people to see if they might be interested. So that's where I'd start off with. And then from there, I'm narrowing and narrowing, narrowing. But the question is really about where do you start? And the answer is with all your tools, with all your resources in order to identify people who might be qualified, interested, and available. Oh, yes. And then I'd use LinkedIn Recruiter to email people in order to, I had a premium license. LinkedIn Recruiter is a premium service from LinkedIn that allows you to message people through the platform in bulk and thus open up conversations to people and talk with them about the role that I was trying to fill. And I know other people do the same thing. They might also post on different websites, whether it was Facebook, Twitter, or specific industry-oriented sites designed to elicit responses, to have conversations, to then submit or get referrals. So I'm just going to check if anyone else has any comments. And I'm just going to remind you that if you do, put it into chat so that in this way I can respond to it. Also, I'm going to mention, come to my website, thebiggamehunter.us, schedule time for a free discovery call, a coaching session, to visit my blog, to find out about my courses, books, and guides. And lastly, you could also subscribe to my YouTube channel, JobSearchTV.com, on YouTube or on Amazon Music, and follow me at No BS Job Search Advice Radio in Apple Podcasts, Spotify, where it's a video podcast, Amazon Music, Google Play, wherever you listen to podcasts, I've got content available. In the meantime, I hope you have a terrific day, and most importantly, be great! Take care.